Good afternoon from very warm Rome, much warmer than in Vienna. So I'm supposed to talk about, as a focus, dark matter search at Bell2, but also showing highlights, results from previous flavor machine CLOE experiment, like CLOE, BES3, Babar and Bell. So actually what I will really talk about is dark matter search at the intensity frontier with the outline of talk you see sketched here. Okay, so we all know that dark matter is very hard because it can be anywhere in span various order of magnitude mass. And in the last decades, there were mainstream literature with preferred so-called Levine-Berg window in a few GV, few TV window opportunity. But if you introduce the possibility of the existence of light mediators, then the situation changes completely. You can have annihilation diagrams like this. And so the real possibility of a light new physics sectors, mostly with the tiny couplings. So in this case, the classic scenario in which you produce new particles at the energy frontier, LHC namely, and you search direct effect of dark matter in underground massive experiments with intensity frontier mostly devoted to discovering virtual effect from a much higher physics scale, can change, and dark matter can be really searched also at the intensity frontier machines, where if one admits the existence of a light dark sector with almost decoupled from a hypothetical large scale new physics within the reach or without or outside the reach of LHC. Of course, whatever the dark matter is, light or heavy, the probability of interaction with the detectors is negligible. So what we really look for is mediators or missing energy signature or both. And we have different cases depending on the mass relationship of dark matter with the mediators. Visible, if it can decay, the mediators can decay only to standard model particles. Invisible, in the opposite case. They can also be long-lived if mass are low or the coupling are tiny. And the off-shell case, which is the hardest one, when the mass of the mediator is outside the square root of S of the machine. There are also additional benefits of having a light dark sector. For example, you can explain astrophysics anomalies, the G minus two, the anomalous G minus two of the muon, also some flavor anomalies, which will be our daily bread in the next decades. And also the presence of light mediators could make limits from the direct exclusion, direct search experiment be escaped because some of these mediators do not interact directly with the quarks and so with the nucleons. At E plus E minus machine, of course, we can't search for dark matter everywhere, but in this range, so from the MeV scale up to most or almost 10 GV. And usually these are subdivision in classification of mediators according to their nature in vector portal, pseudoscalar, scalar, or neutrino portal. So of course, if there is a light dark sector, high intensity experiments are in the best position to probe it because they are working exactly at that scale. Daphne was working at around 1 GeV, BEPC at tau charm threshold, while SuperKEKB, of course, and PEP2 around 4S, so at the bottom threshold. It's, we have to remind that most of the interesting cross section scale like 1/S, so there are very different situations, even, within this machine, with different machine. And these are also unique place to study some rare light meson decays because they are factories, they are supposed to do so. Let's have a look at the collected luminosity by this experiment in the past, CLOE, 2 inverse femtobarn, additional 5, but still not used yet for this search. BES3, if I'm not wrong, something around 15 inverse atobarn, but a different square root of S. So different analysis use different integrated luminosities. Babar, a little bit more than half inverse autobahn. Bell, a little bit less than one inverse autobahn. And Bell 2, which is stronger in progress, collected almost 75 inverse femtobahn up to now. So we start with F4, which is the vector portal extension standard model, QD inspired. One assumes the existence of a new spin one Gibbs boson, which can couple with the standard model, with the hypercharged standard model through the kinetic mixing, this epsilon here, and to dark matter with the coupling alpha D. So again, two basic scenarios, depending on the mass, it can be visible or invisible. At the plus minus machine, there are two main ways of searching for it, in ISR processes or in rare Meson decays. And highlights, the second one, the rare Meson decays. Chloe, for example, looked for a dark photon in the phi to eta plus minus decay channel with eta into three pions. That's a kind of exclusion plot they got at the time of the publication, so that's some years ago. BEST3 is pretty the same thing, but replacing the phi with J psi is natural for, given the nature of this experiment. Again, these are the results. The mostly used method was through ISR production. Chloe did a quite complete job. I show you here, highlight here only the most two peculiar one in electrons, because they were able to go as low as 5 MeV mass, and in pions, they are still nowadays the only experiment who looked for a dark photon in hadronic decay. For example, Babar here excluded the raw region explicitly from the search. BEST3, quite classic search, peak search for in electrons and muon pairs with the photon. So ISR was really a worldwide effort. This is the current situation with the addition of LHCb, which we also heard in the previous talk. The best limits as of now in the interesting region, and so at the Jeff scale, let's say, are detained by Babar. Bell had no suitable triggers for low multiplicity final states. Bell2 has these triggers, but still lacks some data. So this search is currently in preparation. When we will have data, then we will really lead the sensitivity. And of course, competition with the LHCb is expected. We just heard in the previous talk, also because of this very interesting charm decay with an impressive cross-section, at least seen on the scale of plus and minus interaction. Another topology which was searched is the dark Higgs sound. So here one tries to, the attempt is to give an answer to the question, where does the mass of dark photon come from? Because it needs to be massive to explain the associated phenomenology. We know now since 8 years or so that at least in one case, but a really important case, Mother Nature picked up the spontaneous symmetry breaking mechanism. So what we imagine here is, again, in analogy, we assume the existence of a dark Higgs at H prime. And again, the phenomenology depends on the mass relation. For a Higgs, heavy Higgs, it can decay to two dark photons. So that's the equivalent of Higgs to gamma gamma decay in the standard model for a total of 6 charged particles in finite state. So this is a truly two-dimensional search because two particles at the same time, two peaks in the two mass. And in this case, one would populate this region of the phase space. While in the complementary case is for a light X. So in this case, it would be invisible rather than invisible long-lived. So with such long lifetime as to decay outside the detector. And this was searched by Chloe in the limit, of course, allowed by Daphne energy. So the first case, Babar and Bell. This is the final spectrum for Bell. You recognize here the triangular shape. It's you expect a very clean signature, three pairs of tracks, each at the same mass, and staying on the 4S. So no missing energy. Very, very clean signature, almost background-free measurement. which reflects into the limits you can set to the couplings. By the way, the couplings is not simply epsilon over epsilon squared, but is alpha dark times epsilon squared, because there is a dependence on the coupling constant. So usually one displays limit fixing one mass, x in this case, and looking at the upper limit as a function of the other. You see here, Bell and Babar, and here the other way around. Numerically, limits between 10 to the minus 8 and 10 to the minus 9 in alpha d times epsilon squared. Complementary case by Chloe, two muons missing energy signature. This is not a background free measurement. It gets background from charged kaons and trip ions. And the limit, that's the final spectrum, and the limits you get are here. Again, one mass versus fixing one mass and let's say in the looking at the other. Same numerical limits, 10 to minus 8, 10 to minus 9. Of course, they cannot be combined or superimposed with those from Bell and Babar because they belong to different phase space regions. Another search. That's just an highlight, eh? So that not at all the searches have been performed. This is a CPO, the search for an Higgs boson A0, which came out from some non-minimal extension of non-minimal supersymmetric extension of the standard model. In this case, one looks for this A0 in the decay chain 2s, which means actually running the PEP2 or KKB at the 2s and not as usual at 4s. So decaying into 1s and 2 pions, which tag the presence of 1s. And 1s is supposed to decay into a photon and this A0. The A0 then to dark matter, so invisible. So two variables, the missing recoil mass, which tags the 1s, and the energy of the photon, which is related to the mass of the A0. This is an example, the best significance got by Bell, which is not significant at all, of course, and the limit by Bell and Babar for this A0. So we come now to Bell 2. I mean, everybody knows that it's the successor of Bell, which was successfully running in the first decade of the millennium. Bell 2 is a big experiment, more than 1,000 members, more than 100 institutions. So again, it's an asymmetric B factory, and with an aggressive luminosity profile. You can see this here. We are in the instantaneous luminosity across history in the last half century. We are here, this last step, which accounts for a factor 30 in instantaneous luminosity, with the final goal of 50 inverse Attobarn in 10 years from now, which is a factor 50 above Bell. To this corresponds a very rich physics program, which is of course centered around flavor physics, but does not neglect at all dark sector research. That's quite technical, how to go from KKB to super KKB, so how to make out this factor 30. In a word, there is a key word for this, nanobeam scheme, which means roughly reducing the size of the limit interaction point, you see visually here. And also some contribution from an increase of beam currents, not extreme. So together they make this factor 30. Bell 2 detector is strongly upgraded. It's brand detectors in the internal part with the new vertex detector, two layers of pixel. Unfortunately, one is incomplete and four layers of strips. A drift chamber, which is bigger than that of Bell. A new particle identification system, type of propagation counter in the barrel and aerogel in the forward, in the end cap. Same magnet as in Bell, same structure for the calorimeter and for the muon system, both with the brand new electronics. In the case of KLM, the active detector used to be RPC. Now they are partly replaced by scintillators in the barrel and fully replaced by scintillators in the end cap. And that's important, new triggers with dedicated lines for low multiplicity physics. This was not the case in Bell. So overall, Bell 2 is a better detector with much better trigger. Unfortunately, it will have to face worse background condition due to increase of luminosity. And just talking about luminosity, this is what we have been able to do up to now. During 2020, we collected almost 65 in West Fentoban. The run, spring run finished on July 1st, and we'll take again the full run in beginning of October, probably. Overall, including also 2019 data, we have collected about 75 in West Fentoban, to which you have to add the pilot run 2 years ago, 2018, which is quantitatively moving half in West Fentoban, but qualitatively very important because two physics papers came out from this small sample. So the first model we checked is the El Nu minus El Tau model, Z prime. Again, one gauge here, it's a non-minimal dark photon because here what is gauged is the difference of leptonic Nu and Tau number. And because of this difference, of course, one gets anomaly free by construction and couplings only to muon and tau. So it can be produced only as a finite state radiation from a muon or tau leg in a plus minus collisions. That's also enough miracle because in principle one can solve the dark matter puzzle, so predicting the correct relic abundance with two different methods, by the way, with two different scenarios, two different dark matter candidates, sterile neutrinos in one case or light Dirac fermions in another case. So they are two different models, but identical from the mediator point of view. And also the G minus two of the muons, and with additional assumption, also the flavor anomalies. So in Bell 2, we searched for the first time the presence of an invisible Z prime decaying to neutrinos, or even more interesting, to dark matter. Signature is two muons and missing energy, with the system recoiling against two muons peaking somewhere. Main backgrounds are QED process which produce muons and missing energy in the final state. For most of the space, or the mass space, this is a background-free measurement. The sample which was used was the pilot run, even half of the pilot run because of some problem in the trigger. So this data went into our first physics paper publication, PRL, 2 months ago, 3 months ago. And this is the final limit we got. We are a bit, in terms of the coupling constant, we are a bit far from the G minus two, but the expectation is to fill this gap soon. In fact, we have already projections for the luminosity that we have already on tape. Actually, we have even more than this. It will be a new analysis because of course in the pilot run the conditions were dirty and heroically phased, but now we are in another phase. It will still be, as you can see here, this is the background expected, a very low background measurement, almost zero. So the limits are expected to scale like luminosity and not square root, and we are expected to probe seriously the G minus two band, also with the additional dedicated triggers, even better at high mass. Second search is the axion light particles, which appear in many extension of standard model whenever a global symmetry and family flavor symmetry is a good example, gets broken. So they come out as a pseudo-Goldstone boson, and because of this, they are naturally light, they naturally couple to photons, to bosons in general and to photons in particular. And differently from the QCD axions, Quinn and Peccei long time ago, there is no direct relation between mass and coupling. So in Bell 2, we focus on coupling to photons, and we have two main production mechanisms, the Alpstrahlung and the gamma fusion. And even if the gamma fusion two photon finite state is favorable from the cross-section point of view, it's not so from the detection point of view. That this topology, the Alpstrahlung, is easier, is cleaner, and so we focused on the Alpstrahlung. Three photon topology in the resolved case, which is what we faced in Bell 2. But life is not, is hard sometimes, so there are cases for low masses of the axion light particle when the two photons are so close that the calorimeter cannot disentangle them anymore. And so this show up as a two-photon topology. And the worst thing is that the worst case is that it can be suppressed at trigger level if some veto for the standard model di passi minus to gamma gamma process, which is a high cross section, is in force. It's not the case yet, but in the future it's not excluded. Another case is when either because of the mass, low mass, or because of the low coupling, the particle gets enough lifetime to decay outside of the detector, and one is left with only the recoil photon. So one photon, single photon topology, which is shared also by the case in which this particle can decay to dark matter. So we have one, two, and three photon topology. In Bell 2, by now, we just searched the three photon topology, the cleanest one, by looking at peaks either in the diphoton mass system or in the system recoiling against this isolated photon. Different masses at different resolution. You see there is a turning point where one method is more convenient than the other. So we study both spectra, recoil and direct, and this is the data compared as Monte Carlo. So if you are jumping on the chair because of this, you can sit down quietly, because if you look zoomed with a smaller scale, then you see that this does not appear really as a peak, but it's a quite diffused excess, which probably point to some trivial issue in the Monte Carlo in the simulation, but certainly not a peak, not a real peak. So this was the subject of our second physics paper by Bell 2, which will be submitted to physical review letters in a matter of days. These are the limits, which we observed as usual compared to expected, translated in terms of the coupling. So this is the first time this is presented in this conference, worldwide. So you see that we set limits which are in our range, even one order of magnitude better than the previous one. E gamma gamma means essentially LEP here. These are coming from LEP. Also, we plan to search for dark Higgs-Stralun process in the Chloe fashion, let's say. So here in this region for lighter Higgs boson. So in this triangle. That's why you see all these triangle now appearing, the two mass one versus the other. It's the same final state as for the Z prime, two mu and a missing energy. So the same background source are contributing, and you see how differently they populate the phase space. This is the efficiency. You see here a problem. We are almost blind for light dark photon masses. This is due to an inefficiency of the trigger, which is cured this year with a specific dedicated tracking trigger and also with the introduction of KLM single muon trigger. Nevertheless, we decide to use the 2019 data, so without this trigger, because we already get very interesting sensitivity just with this small sample. And you see here, so these are the sensitivity we get. Limits, I remind you, are in terms of epsilon square times alpha dark. What I mean is a non-trivial coupling. Means that if we set arbitrarily, of course, the coupling constant, the dark coupling constant to one, we get limit in terms of epsilon square, which are better than the best available in this region, which are those set by Babar. But even setting alpha, for example, to 0.1, 10 to the minus one, so in the QCD range, so to say, then still we have a region more or less here where limits in terms of epsilon square are better than the available one. Okay. So I'm going to the invisible dark photon. So same thing, but this time is invisible. So the only thing that we are left with is photon. We saw examples similar in LHC where this can be also object of different nature. Of course, this means that a single photon trigger is needed, which was not available in Bell and only partly available in Babar. Also, you need an excellent knowledge of the acceptance, because a QED process can produce photons which, once lost in the gaps, can mimic the signal. signature is a peak in the energy of photon or kinematically equivalent way in the recoil system against the photon. You see visually here how gap they contribute and they produce these funny bands in the two main analysis variables, which are the energy of the photon and the angle of the emission. So it's crucial to the usage of the muon system to seal the apparatus and to cover the gap, which fortunately do not coincide, which are left in the current. The main ingredient of this analysis is the single photon trigger. We have it in three different flavors at a decreasing threshold to 1 and 0.5. Of course, there are other things which are not the same beside the threshold, otherwise we would always use the lowest one. Here is an example how the one jet threshold works perfectly in data. This was measured with mimogram events, wonderful plateau, very close to 100%. So this is a threshold, the lowest one, 0.5, much more aggressive than what was considered in the physics book. This is an excellent reason to make this measurement as soon as possible using this data, because this is not guaranteed to survive with increase of luminosity. Or the contrary, it's guaranteed not to survive probably in 2 years from now. So the world situation now is led by Babar, which is a measurement here. And we claim that with the sample, with the luminosity more than a factor two less than Babar, we make much better. And this is due to the calorimeter structure, which has no projective cracks in phi, which means better hermeticity. And also two factors combined, the smaller boost of the machine and the larger calorimeter size together make a larger acceptance. And also the usage of KLM. So we will see. I quickly go to summary. And persisting null results from LHC and RA search make more and more attractive the possibility of a light dark sector scenario. The experiments at intensity frontier are in the best position. There was a great job by Chloe, Chloe 2, Base 3, Babar and Bell, which excluded the full models or relevant part of parameter space of these models. And then jumping to Bell 2, started operation 2 years ago and collected 75 inverse pentoban up to now with a broad program of dark search, much broader than what I showed you today. For example, I didn't talk you about dark scalars, light ticks, long-lived particle signature, inelastic dark matter, magnetic monopoles, and much more. The first physics results are coming, and one publication is out. The other one is really incoming. Next paper will be the dark instrument search, presumably first half of next year, and with some optimism, the invisible dark photon search, at least the result. I'm not sure, I would not swear about the publication by the end of next year. Thank you.